Melbourne has been served by electric suburban trains for just over a century, and during that time, numerous different train types have been used. Most have operated for many decades, with some individual trains running in service for over 70 years. In this video, we're going to take a look at the timeline of these trains' service lives, and along the way, have a brief look at some notable features of each type. Melbourne's suburban network is electrified at 1500 volts DC using overhead wires, and at the time of the original project was one of the biggest suburban railway electrification schemes anywhere in the world. The scale of the project was ahead of its time and really shaped the way Melbourne would grow into the future. When the first public electric services commenced in 1919, operations began with two distinct types of electric multiple unit train. The flagship fleet of the electrification program were the Tait trains, named after Thomas Tait, a Victorian Railways Commissioner, and later having a popular YouTube channel named after them. Built at Newport Workshops, the Taits were timber-bodied trains and featured open saloon seating and sliding external doors, which were often left open while running. The inside of these trains was highly ornate, with pressed metal ceilings, leather upholstery, and framed photographs on the end walls. While the Taits were built specifically as electric trains, the first sets were completed in 1910, nearly a decade before electric service commenced. The project had been delayed by World War I, but that didn't stop the Taits being used in suburban service. They were steam-hauled for those first 9 years of life. Just a quick note, I always like to use footage I've taken myself in these videos, and as my own timeline doesn't reach back all that far, all the images you'll see here are of preserved examples I've photographed in the last 2 decades. The other type of train were known as swingdoors because of their outward swinging doors, which, unlike the Taits, could not be left open while the train was moving, for obvious reasons. The swingdoor sets were also commonly known as dog boxes or doggies. This came from the internal layout of the cars, which was made up of full-width compartments with no corridor. So once you were on board, there was no way of moving along the train. This, of course, meant you were stuck sitting with whoever else chose to board that same compartment. Unlike the Taits, the swingdoor cars were not originally built with electric traction in mind. They were steam-hauled passenger cars built way back in the 1880s and 90s. For electrification, they received new, stronger underframes and were fitted with electrical equipment, and the driving cars were given cabs similar in appearance to the Tait cars. To the casual observer, Tait and swingdoor trains look very similar, but there are actually numerous differences. Aside from the different internal layouts and door types which I already mentioned, the swingdoor cars are slightly narrower and slightly shorter than the Tait cars, and the cab is very slightly squarer. The swingdoor cars also have running boards along the sides. The two types were electrically compatible and could run in multiple unit, which was fairly unusual in regular service, but it did happen. Here we see some of the preserved cars making up a mixed set on a tour in 2003. This train is made up of two swingdoor motor cars with a Tait trail car in between. You can clearly see the larger proportions of the Tait car. In this example, the two types are also painted in different colour schemes, however that's just because these particular cars were restored to represent different eras in history. And historically, both types went through both those liveries, and both were later painted bright red, which is the colour most people actually remember them being, and led to the common nickname Red Rattlers. For 3.5 decades, the Tait and swingdoor sets made up the entire suburban fleet, but by the early 50s it was clear that more trains were needed. In 1956, a brand new type of train began to enter service. Known as Harris trains, after another former VR commissioner, these were Melbourne's first steel-bodied suburban cars. They were painted in the VR's distinctive blue and gold livery and became known to the public as blue trains. The motor cars were built in Gloucester, England, while the trailer cars were built by local firm Martin & King. These trains were permitted to run at a top speed of 115 kilometers per hour, which is still the top speed for suburban trains today. This compared to the 80k top speed of the Tait and swingdoor trains, although it should be mentioned they didn't actually have speedometers, so that was slightly open to interpretation. The next type to enter service were the Hitachi trains, which began hitting the network in 1972. Going by the name, you might think these trains were built by Japanese company Hitachi, however, they weren't. The motor cars were built by Martin & King in Bayswater and fitted out at Somerton, while the trailer cars were built at the VR's own Newport Workshops. They were fitted with electrical equipment designed by Hitachi, but manufactured in Australia by Clyde Engineering. The trains were initially known as Martin & King cars, or Silvers, as they entered service in a plain exposed stainless steel, but for some reason later became known as Hitachi's, despite the relatively small involvement of that company in their history. The Hitachi trains featured heating for passengers, but not air conditioning, and they were also fitted with power-operated doors. The passenger windows dropped down from the top, so you had to stand up to get the full open window experience. Despite their size, these windows didn't provide great ventilation, and later in life the Hitachi trains were known to get very hot in summer. So for the first time, Melbourne had four different types in service, and it was a colourful selection with red, blue and silver trains all running around. It seems quite strange that the VR didn't standardise the livery and was happy having each type in a different colour. Within a couple of years, enough Hitachi sets had been delivered to allow retirement of the now ancient Swingdoor trains, the last of which were withdrawn in January 1974. They had been running as electric trains for an impressive 55 years, but including their previous life as steam-hauled cars, many were actually in their early 80s. It's quite remarkable that kids were travelling to school in the 1970s in 19th century carriages. Then in 1981, there was a real leap forward in technology with the introduction of the Comeng trains. These trains were built by their namesake, Comeng, short for Commonwealth Engineering, at Dandenong in suburban Melbourne. These trains had airbag suspension and air conditioning, and entered service in the striking Vicrail livery, being mostly plain stainless steel with tangerine lining. The government promoted them as super trains, and they must have seemed very futuristic compared to the ageing wooden Taits which they had arrived to replace. By 1984, enough Comeng sets had arrived that the Taits could finally be withdrawn, ending the era of wooden suburban trains in Melbourne. The Taits had reached a grand old age of 74 years in service, 65 of those operating with electric traction. Even though they were very run down by this stage, their long service life was an amazing achievement, and I doubt any other train will ever beat that record. By this stage, the Harris trains were starting to feel pretty worn out, and a plan was hatched for a major refurbishment program to help extend their lives. 16 cars, making up four car sets, were heavily rebuilt, fitted with air conditioning and a dramatically updated external appearance. These trains quickly became known as grey ghosts, and by all accounts were quite unsuccessful. The refurb had made them heavier, and they were now quite sluggish, living out their remaining years on the relatively flat Sandringham, St Kilda and Port Melbourne lines. It was found to be cheaper and easier to order more Comeng sets instead, and no further grey ghosts were created. However, a further 50 Harris cars were given a new life, being converted into locomotive-hauled passenger cars for use on V-line country trains. Known as H-sets, these cars are still in service today, over 60 years since they first entered service as suburban cars. In 1988, the remaining blue Harris cars were found to contain a large amount of asbestos and were withdrawn from service. Many of them were wrapped in plastic and buried in tips at Clayton and Dandenong, never to be seen again. The grey ghosts continued to run for a few more years, being withdrawn in 1991. And so Melbourne was back down to only two types of train again, a situation that would remain for the next decade, with one small exception. In the early 90s, there was some interest in introducing a fleet of double-deck trains in Melbourne, and to test the concept, a single four-car train was purchased. Built in Broadmeadow, New South Wales, this train was known as the 4D, standing for Double Deck Development and Demonstration. Its external design was based heavily on Sydney's Tangara trains, however there are many visible differences and its proportions were slightly different to fit Melbourne's loading gauge. While it looked like a Tangara cosmetically, it was electrically more similar to a Melbourne Comeng, with which it was able to run coupled in multiple unit. In service, it ran exclusively on the Lilydale and Belgrave lines, which had some infrastructure modifications to allow it to run. However, right from the start, the 4D proved to be an unreliable train. It frequently broke down and spent more of its life in sidings than actually carrying passengers. Being an only child, spare parts were not always close at hand, and repairs were often delayed. It spent some very lengthy periods out of service, being occasionally resuscitated up until 2002 when it was officially withdrawn from service. I remember seeing it sitting right down the back of Ringwood Yard around that time. It was taken to Newport workshops and stored for a few years, being conveniently left in this siding visible over the fence of the Newport Railway Museum. Then in 2006 it was towed to Sims Metal and cut up into little pieces. The sad part of the 4D story is that ultimately it sort of did the opposite of what it was designed to do. Whenever people raise the possibility of double-deckers in Melbourne today, the discussion always gets ruined by people going, "We can't have double-deckers, remember the 4D? It was always breaking down." But of course, the reliability issues related to that specific train, not to the fact it had two levels of seating. Anyway, back to the main story. Around came the new millennium, and with it, privatisation of the rail network, which was sliced in half and handed to two separate operators. I've made a whole other video about that if you're interested. Each operator ordered their own new trains, so for the first time in history, two new train types entered service very close together. Connex ordered a fleet of X-trapless trains built by Alstom in France, and these entered service in 2002. The suspension on these trains was stepped backwards, being coil springs rather than airbags, giving a rather bouncy ride. For the first time in Melbourne, the driver sat in the middle of the cab rather than on the left, and some signals had to be repositioned to maintain sighting. They are also notorious for slipping and sliding on wet rails, creating a noticeable shudder for passengers. However, despite these failings, they are now Melbourne's most reliable train type, and numerous more sets have been ordered over the years, with the last batch arriving in early 2020. Connex's competitor, M-Train, bought their new trains from Siemens in Germany, and after a few teething problems, they entered service in 2003. In the next few years, these trains shot to fame by having a number of rather public brake failures, resulting in temporary speed restrictions and eventually sanders being fitted, something no other suburban train had ever needed. However, once those issues were resolved, the Siemens have proved to be a very reliable fleet and give a much smoother and quieter ride than the X-Travelers sets. As the privatisation era trains were entering service, the Comeng fleet, which was now about 20 years old, went through a major refurbishment program, actually two separate refurbishment programs on behalf of the two private operators. This included new fiberglass fronts that significantly altered these trains' appearance, and you can still clearly see those differences today. The introduction of the Siemens and X-Trampolines was supposed to allow the withdrawal of the Hitachi fleet, which were now entering their early 30s. The majority of them were withdrawn between 2003 and 2005, with many going to scrap at that time. However, Melbourne was due to host the Commonwealth Games in 2006, and it was decided to keep six-car Hitachi sets in service to help with the projected crowds. The Games came and went, and a handful of people, including myself, spent a lot of time rushing around taking pictures, expecting them to vanish at any moment. However, patronage on the network as a whole was climbing, and the last six Hitachis continued to run. In 2007, a seventh set, which had been set aside for preservation, was hired back and returned to service. Because the future of these trains had been so uncertain for so long, very little care had been taken in maintaining them, and they were all filthy and still wearing the remains of their green and yellow Met colours from the 90s. By 2007, it was pretty obvious that they were still needed for a few more years, so they were given a light refurbishment, finally receiving a proper clean and Connex livery. They were fitted with tinted windows in an attempt to keep the saloon cooler in summer, and the interiors got bright handrails and seat fabric, which clashed awkwardly with the 70s faux timber panelling. So the Hitachis managed to look pretty smart in their remaining few years, but they were pretty much done by the end of 2013, and a final farewell tour was run in April 2014. The next addition to the fleet marked a radical change in design for Melbourne's suburban fleet. Known as high-capacity metro trains, or HCMT for short, these trains were ordered specifically for use through the Melbourne Metro Tunnel, which is still under construction at the time of writing. The first public run of an HCMT occurred in the last few days of December 2020, when one ran a single return service from Pakenham to the city and back, with regular services beginning later in January 2021. The car bodies were built by CRRC in China, but most other components are built locally and the trains are being assembled in Melbourne at Newport workshops. These solid-looking trains are slightly longer than other current members of the fleet and, as the name suggests, feature a high-capacity metro-style interior layout, with lots of standing room and handrails, although still with a lot of transverse seating. Until the metro tunnel opens, they are running exclusively on the Cranbourne and Pakenham lines running through the city loop. Ultimately, they will run from these lines through the metro tunnel and onto Sunbury. The metro tunnel stations are going to be fitted with platform screen doors, as seen on many actual metros, and as a result, the HCMTs will operate in an automated mode through the tunnel. It's also expected that these trains will run on the line to Melbourne Airport whenever we finally get around to building it. So that brings us up to the present day in 2022, and once again, we have four types of train on the network. The introduction of HCMTs has allowed the withdrawal of Comenges to begin, with many having already been stored or scrapped. However, there aren't enough new trains to displace them completely, and it's expected that a number of Comenges will remain in service until the next new trains start arriving, which are expected to be an X-Travelers 2.0, due to be constructed in the next couple of years. So, now that we've journeyed through 103 years worth of Melbourne's electric trains, where can you see examples of them all today? Well, the good news is, with the exception of the poor old 4D, there are still publicly accessible examples of every one of these trains. At the Newport Railway Museum, you can check out a Swingdoor car, a Blue Harris, a Grey Ghost, and a Hitachi. You may see the odd suburban car repurposed on private property, including a large number of Hitachi cars all around the country, as well as the three well-known cars plonked on a roof in Collingwood, one of which is part of a burger joint called Easy's. But the really fun thing to do is ride a historic electric train on the main line, and you can still do that thanks to SteamRail Victoria and their electric division known as ElecRail. Their beautifully restored Tait set returned to public tours on the network in 2022 after an 18-year absence. This is a marvellous train to travel on, and played a really big part in launching my railway interest when I first rode it around 20 years ago. If you want to ride it yourself, I'll put a link down below showing where to check for upcoming tours. Sadly, it's no longer possible to ride in a Swingdoor car after all the operational cars were tragically destroyed by arson in 2015. However, it may happen again one day, with volunteers currently working on one car as a long-term project. At the time of writing, it doesn't look like we'll see a Harris or Hitachi restored to working order anytime soon, although you can still technically ride a Harris in the form of the V-Line H sets I mentioned earlier, which are still going strong, but there really isn't much left of their suburban train heritage. Apart from the ones in the museum, only two other Harris cars survive. This pair were modified for use as a rail greasing train in the late 80s and were used for that purpose up until 2002. They are now in storage at Newport Workshops and can be viewed by the public every 2 years at the open weekend. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed the video and maybe learnt a thing or two about Melbourne's wonderful electric trains. Don't forget to go ride a Comeng before they're all gone, and thanks for watching.